Welcome everyone. Thank you for joining us for our Harlow College Open Event. I'm Leanne, I work for marketing and I'll be overseeing this open event today. And also in the background is my colleague Jasmine, who will be helping me with that. Delivering the first part of your open event today will be our A-levels team. So how this webinar will work is our presenters will share their information with you. They can't see you, but you should be able to see them alongside any information they wish to share on screen. Our presenters and other attendees can't hear you. However, you will be able to ask questions throughout the webinar using the Q&A feature. If you're using a computer, this will be at the bottom of your screen. If you're using a mobile device, tap the screen and this Q&A feature will appear at the top. Someone will either answer your questions live or answer it on the Q&A feed. Ask your questions as we go along, ask as many as you possibly can, and we will save some time at the end of the subject presentations to answer as many as we can live. Please be aware that your name will appear next to your question, but you can click Ask Anonymously. We are recording this webinar and you will receive an email with a link to the recording. This will also be available on the Harlow College website. I'm now going to hand you over to our Head of A-Levels, Tracy, for our A-Levels event. Don't forget to send in your questions using the Q&A feature.
Hello everybody, my name is Tracy Greenall and I am Head of Academy for the Academy that includes A-Levels, Vocational Science and Engineering. In this session, I'm going to be talking about the A-Level Department and what it would be like studying A-Levels at Harlow College. I'm going to be joined tonight by Satiri Adamopoulos, who's going to be answering your questions on the Q&A feed. So if you'd like to pop your questions into that, he'll be answering those for you. And he's got lots of knowledge because he's the head of the A-Level Department. So next slide, please. So yeah, welcome to the A-Level Department. And why should you choose Harlow College and A-Levels? So first of all, A-Levels. So they are a predominantly academic program. Learners normally do three or four subjects that they would do for 2 years that would enable them to then progress onwards depending on their progression pathway. Entry requirements are quite varied and we would suggest that you go and look at the specifics on the website, but generally the learners need an average score of 5 from their 7 best GCSEs. This needs to include maths, at least one English and science. Each subject does have its own entry requirements and it's always a good idea for learners to be thinking about their A-level subjects now to consider what grades they're going to need in their GCSEs. Most learners doing A-levels do progress to university. And we've got a list there of the brilliant universities that learners have secured places at in the last year and the kinds of courses that they would study. So they're varied. You're looking at subjects like aerospace engineering, veterinary science, medicine and modern languages. Next slide, please. So as I've mentioned, most learners doing A-levels do progress to university, although many are now looking at the option of doing a higher apprenticeship. So a higher apprenticeship is where you study your university degree whilst doing a job. And this has many benefits to it. Notable one being that your employer pays for your degree for you. So this means you don't incur the university debt that we all know about. It also means that when you graduate from university, you're in a job already, so you're not having to worry about finding that position. Now, apprenticeships are varied at higher level, and we've had learners go off to do things like train to become a fully qualified solicitor at Evershed Sutherland, based in Cambridge. You can do apprenticeships in nursing, and we've got learners currently doing apprenticeships in nursing at Princess Alexandra Hospital, and cybersecurity as well, which is a growing field for learners to get into, and you can work for a variety of companies, including the British government. Next slide, please. So what would Harlow College A-level timetable look like? So we're a little bit different to how timetables might be structured at another sixth form in a secondary school. We work on a half day basis. So what this means is that learners do half day lessons. They're 3 hour long lessons. And it allows learners to have more time for really delving into the subject, what we like to call deep learning. When learners are not timetabled for a session, so that would be a half day, they're not expected to be at college. And this means that they're not left waiting here for a lesson. Of course, if it's a whole morning or a whole afternoon, that means they can be at home working, or they can be here in a workshop working, COVID regulations permitting. For each subject, learners will have between 5 and 6 hours of contact time per subject per week. Next slide, please. So we offer a range of A-level subjects. We have them listed there. So we've got the classic subjects, what we call facilitating subjects, and we'll look at those in a little bit more detail in a moment, as well as subjects that learners won't have studied at GCSE. So we would advise all learners to look carefully at the kinds of subjects that we offer to see if anything interests them that maybe they haven't considered before and have never studied before. Learners can also combine BTEC law with an A-level. It's done over the 2 years and it's equivalent to an A-level. Next slide, please. So we're always asking learners to tell us about any subjects that we don't offer that they might be interested in. So in the last couple of years, learners have shown an interest in philosophy and EPQ, and those are now part of our curriculum. So we would say to learners, when you're putting your application in or when you're having your interview, if there is a subject you're interested in, let us know and we can consider whether there's enough interest to put it into our curriculum. Next slide, please. So this is a sample option block timetable. It changes every year depending on the interest of the applicants. But as you can see, we have 5 option blocks. Learners would be expected to choose 3 or 4 subjects from 3 or 4 of these option blocks. Now I've given an example here of a learner who has chosen politics from option A, sociology from option B, law from option C, and business from option E. So in this case, the learner's chosen 4 subjects and hasn't chosen any subject from option D. In this case, they would be in 4 mornings a week and 4 afternoons studying their 4 subjects. They wouldn't be in subject lessons on Thursday morning or Monday afternoon. In one of those slots, though, we would put a thing called learner mentor. This is a bit like form, and it's where we're predominantly looking at the pastoral aspect of the program with the learner, as well as their progression. Next slide, please. So, how to choose the subjects. We absolutely understand that for some learners, it's really difficult choosing the subjects you want to study. Our advice is look at the subjects that we offer. Consider if there's a career you want to go into and whether you need to pick some of the subjects we offer to meet either the university entry requirements or the necessary requirements for that career. Think about what subjects you enjoy at GCSE. Are you a scientist? Do you love numbers? Are you more of a writer? Are you quite creative? If you've got interests that spread over a range of subjects, what you might want to think about doing is splitting the subjects that you choose, so you're kind of keeping your options open. So we've given an example here of a student who might pick, for example, maths and business because they've got quite a head for numbers, they're quite interested in business, they're thinking they might want to go down the financial route, but also they might think, actually, I'm really interested in social sciences, sociology and psychology. They may or may not have chosen those subjects at GCSE, or they might have looked at the content of the course and thought, oh, that looks really interesting. I might want to study that at university. So by choosing those 4 subjects, a learner has kept their options very much open for progression pathways after their A-levels. Now, some learners might want to consider taking a facilitating subject. These are subjects that are particularly desirable by some universities, in particular Oxford and Cambridge, and for learners wanting to get into degrees that have higher entry requirements, like veterinary and medicine. Next slide, please. So the universities classes, Russell Group Universities, they're the 24 leading UK universities, and these are the universities that would probably like to see a facilitating subject on an application, at least one. So the subjects that a class is facilitating, excuse me, are English literature, history, modern languages, maths and further maths, physics, biology, chemistry and geography. So the subjects there that learners might want to join with other subjects that we offer just to strengthen an application if they were thinking, yes, I think I might like to go to a Russell Group university. Next slide, please. So alongside the academic portion of the programme, Harlow College Sixth Form also has an enrichment element to it, just like you would find in a sixth form in a secondary school. As I've already mentioned, we offer EPQ, the Extended Project Qualification, which is highly desired by universities. We have a number of different clubs and societies which run COVID permitting, and these can be both academic as well as physical activities like sports and team activities. So in particular, we encourage learners to develop new skills, maybe skills that aren't linked to their A-level programme, such as coding. So for learners who aren't necessarily doing computer science is an A-level subject, they might want to do coding because they recognise it's a really good skill, a desired skill that might benefit them in the future. Courses, different subjects have lots of trips, visits to different places and speakers that come in, again COVID permitting. Just today we've run an online seminar for the geography students, so we're looking at different ways that we can undertake these activities to keep the enrichment element part of the A-level programme. When we're allowed to, we also enjoy taking learners on international trips, so going abroad. Last couple of trips we've gone to Ghana, where we've worked in the local community, and our next trip we'd be planning on going to Greece to do turtle conservation. Many of our learners like to undertake national citizen service. It really develops their confidence, their team building skills, and they come out of it feeling like they've had a really good time, and they turn to that quite a lot when we're talking to them about how they're developing for going off to university or into a job. We also have a number of schemes here at college that learners can get involved with. So the ambassador scheme, this is where learners apply to be an ambassador for the college. And when we have open evenings that happen here on site, they would be taking visitors round. They do the same thing when we have visitors come from organisations. And learners can also apply to be on the board of governors. All of our learners get iPads, and we're developing their digital competence throughout their time at Harlow College. So another skill that they can employ when they progress on from the college. Next slide, please. So just a couple of pictures here from our trip when we went to Ghana. So getting the students involved in lots of different activities that really benefit them, they boost their confidence and gives them lots of things to take away that they can link to their progression after Harlow College. Next slide, please. So we have a number of ways that we support the learners throughout their 2 years at Harlow College, in the same way that they would have in a secondary school sixth form. So in the first 6 weeks, we do a review of their progress to check that they're on the right programme, they've chosen the right subjects, they're enjoying the course. We also have parents' evening in that first 6 weeks. We look at whether learners want to change pathways, whether they are on the right course that's going to get them to their end destination, and make plans for progressing after college. So we're working with them on that the whole time. We're looking at work placements when we're able to do those. So quite a lot of work placements currently are virtual, online, where the learners are still getting that sort of work experience, although in a slightly different format. We have lots of links with employees where we're developing the learners' understanding of different kinds of careers that they can go into. As I've mentioned, most learners do go to university, and we look at UCAS and university progression from the start of the A-level programme, and we're helping them throughout the entire process of applying to university, but we also look at things like apprenticeships and are going straight into a job or onto another course after the college. Other kinds of support that is available includes any kind of learning support that learners might have had at GCSE that can continue in their A levels and counselling. Next slide, please. Course costs, well, this depends on what subjects the learners do. It will generally include textbooks, any equipment like calculators, fees for use of art equipment, media, and lab costs for the sciences. If there are trips, there might be costs associated with those as well. We'll give details of all these costs at enrolment. Next slide, please. Right, top tips on how to apply. Get your application done as soon as possible. Some schools support with this process, but don't worry if your school doesn't. The application, as soon as it comes in, it will generate an interview with us, and we can give learners much more support if they're unsure as to which subjects they want to do. We'll give an interview. At the moment they're on the phone, but hopefully we'll be able to go face to face in the new year. Then we can give advice as well if learners are unsure whether they want to do A levels or a different kind of programme. Hopefully we'll be able to have more open evening events and taste the days in June when learners can come in and try the subjects. And then we have an induction before the start of the sixth form year in August. Next slide, please. As I've already mentioned, we provide lots of student support for progression. So looking at careers and giving advice and guidance. We have a safeguarding department here who will look after the students. If they have any concerns, they can go to the safeguarding department on their own, or they can be supported by a teacher to access the safeguarding department. And we have all that learning support that we talked about earlier for learners that might be getting that sort of support now. So for any learning needs that they might have, and we can support with that carrying on from their GCSEs. Next slide, please. So applications are now open. We would advise you get your application in as soon as possible, and then that will generate your interview with us, and interviews will start from January. Next slide, please. Right, so let's have a quick look and see if we've got any questions. I have seen some ping up on the screen, so I'm just going to have a look and see. So question here, can I apply for sixth form at my school and college? Absolutely, you can apply for as many sixth forms as you want. So that's not a problem at all. It's a bit like applying for university. So apply for as many as you want, and then you can choose where you want to go. You can leave it as late as when you get your GCSE results, to be honest. That is not a problem at all. How many A levels can you study alongside BTEC Law? Right, so yeah, you can study a minimum of 2 A levels alongside BTEC Law, so that would count for your 3 subjects. Or you can do 3 subjects alongside it. So BTEC Law counts as an A level. So whether you're doing 3 or 4 equivalent, you can add that alongside. So it just fits into the timetable the same as an A-level subject. So I'm just going to have a quick look, see what other subjects. Do you have to do maths alongside further maths, or can you just do further maths? No, you have to do maths if you're going to do further maths. So you can do further maths on its own, but if you're really into your maths and you want to take that forward, then you would do maths and further maths. You can't leapfrog it and go straight to the further maths, I'm afraid. Will there be opportunities to speak with careers advisors? Absolutely. So we have the STAR agency. So we have careers advisors within the STAR agency who you can have one-to-one conversations with. But within those learner mentor sessions that I mentioned, we also have careers advice going on in those, where we will support you to look at your careers. How do you get to that end destination? And do you have to go to university? Can you do an apprenticeship? What are your options? And we do that throughout the entire A-level programme. Right, I think my time is up now. So I know there's lots of other questions here. What we'll do is we'll get those answered, and we will put those on another information document so that you can get the answers to those. So I'm going to hand back to Leanne now, and thank you very much for watching.
Thank you, Tracy. We're going to move on to our science open event now, and welcome to any new attendees that have joined us today. If you've asked a question during our A-level presentation, don't worry, Satiri's on it and he will answer your questions as soon as he can. And if you would still like to ask some A-level questions, if you've got some burning questions, just start your question from now on with A-levels, and then our A-level team will know when to answer your question. Welcome everyone, thank you for joining us for our Harlow College Open event. I'm Leanne, I work for marketing and I'll be overseeing the open event today. And also in the background is my colleague Jasmine, who will be helping me with that. Delivering your science open event today will be our science team. So how this webinar will work is our presenters will share their information with you. They can't see you, but you should be able to see them alongside any information they wish to share on screen. Our presenters and other attendees can't hear you. However, you will be able to ask questions throughout the webinar using the Q&A feature. If you're using a computer, this will be at the bottom of your screen. If you're using a mobile device, tap the screen and this will appear at the top. Someone will either answer your questions live or answer it on the Q&A feed. Ask your questions as we go along and we will save some time at the end of the subject presentations to answer as many as we can live. Please be aware that your name will appear next to your question, but you can click Ask Anonymously. We are recording this webinar and you will receive an email with a link to the recording. This will be also available on the Harlow College website. I'm now going to hand you over to our Head of Science, Tracy, for our Science Open event. Don't forget to send in your questions using the Q&A feature.
Sorry, there we go, I'll mute now. Good evening, everybody. My name is Tracy Greenall and I'm head of academy that includes the A-level vocational science and engineering team. In this session, I'm going to give you some information about what it's like studying vocational science at Harlow College. I'm joined by Jane Roberts, one of the managers for the science department, and she will be answering your questions on the live Q&A feed. So do ping your questions into her. Next slide, please. Right, so applied science. Next slide. Right, so the vocational science program is made up of two different levels. So we've got both the level 2 and the level 3 program, and what level a learner enrolls onto depends on what their qualifications on entry are going to be. So learners who successfully complete the Level 2 Vocational Science Programme have the ability to progress on to the Level 3 if they would like to continue down the science pathway. And the majority of those learners tend to do that, but sometimes they decide they might want to go a slightly different pathway, particularly into related areas such as health and social care or sport. To get onto the level 3 programme, learners would need to get at least 4.4 in GCSE science if they're doing combined or double science, or a 4 in 2 sciences if they're doing triple science, or MM, so merit in the level 2 science programme if they've done BTEC level 2, and they would need a 4 in their English and their maths. Most of the vocational science learners at level 3 do progress to university, and quite a few of them now are also considering higher apprenticeships and as an alternative to going straight to university. This is where they do their degree alongside working, and has the benefit that they don't incur the cost of going to university. So these kinds of apprenticeships might be in things like nursing and paramedic. Next slide, please. So what kinds of routes can you do after you've done vocational science? So there's such a wide variety of science areas that you can go into. The classics you're going to be looking at things are, you know, nursing, midwifery, lab technician, but it can also be things like engineering, environmental science, psychology. And we've had learners that have gone into all of those fields from the level 3 vocational course. We've also got a lot of learners who are seeing the sense in doing a higher apprenticeship now. So they get their degree alongside working. And there are a number of brilliant companies that are taking on higher apprentices, such as GlaxoSmithKline and Rolls-Royce. And learners are taking advantage of these opportunities to get their degree alongside working. Next slide, please. And here we've got some examples of some of our lovely learners that we've had and where they've progressed on to. So you can get an idea of the kinds of grades that the learners have been achieving and what they've used that course, that qualification to go on to do. So these learners going off to do a variety of subjects at university using their level 3 qualification. Next slide, please. So what kinds of subjects will you cover on the course? Whether you're doing the level 2 or the level 3 vocational science program, you will always cover some biology, some chemistry, some physics, as well as developing your maths and English skills. There is theory elements to the program. So this is where you're learning the theory behind the topic that you're studying, as well as lots of practical activities that learners do. So this is taking that theory and putting it into practice. Learners will be using industry quality equipment. So this is giving learners the skills and the understanding of how to use this equipment in preparation for either going to university to undertake a science program, or to go into the workplace. And we're also teaching learners the protocols, things such as health and safety, which is vital when you're using chemicals and equipment in the science lab. The programmes and how learners attain the qualifications is through a combination of coursework as well as examination assessments. Next slide, please. So for level 2 learners, they're in for the equivalent of 2.5 days. And in addition to their main program, they will also be doing English and maths classes alongside these 2.5 days as is required by the learner. For level 3 learners, they're in for the equivalent of 3 days. For both of these programs, so level 2 and level 3, as I've mentioned, it's a mixture of theory-based and practical sessions, and learners will be doing a mixture of those throughout the sessions that they're on site. In addition to their program lessons, we also put on additional sessions for the learners. So we call these workshops, and this is where we support the learners to complete the coursework required for the program. And we also put on revision sessions when we've got exams coming up for those programs. Next slide, please. Now, all learners are expected to do work experience. So we want a minimum of at least 30 hours of work experience. That's a week's worth of work experience for each learner, but many learners undertake much more than this. So we have a thing called an extended work placement, and learners often want to undertake these because it strengthens applications for university and for these really good higher apprenticeships that are incredibly competitive. Other learners have to undertake these work experience placements, the extended work placements, to meet the entry requirements for certain university degrees. So we support the learners to be looking at what they want to do from the very beginning, so they understand what kinds of experience they need to get on their CV so that they meet the entry requirements for these programs. So work experience might be specific to their career goals, or it might be giving the learners experience so that they can get an idea as to what kind of science careers are out there. So classic work placements might be at Princess Alexandra Hospital if learners are interested in going into the field of medicine, or in nature reserves if they're interested in maybe a career in conservation and wildlife management. Next slide, please. So as I mentioned, we've got industry quality equipment that learners can use to get experience to understand how to use this equipment when they're in university laboratories or in industry. We have 6 modern science laboratories, and we have technicians with lots of equipment that can support those learners doing those practicals alongside the staff, the teaching staff. So the learners are also able to use a fully equipped computer suite, and also the iPads that all learners receive on starting the programme. We look at finding apps that then link the equipment up to their iPads so they can start using programmes that they would be using at university and in the work placement. Next slide, please. At the moment, all of our laboratories, like all of our teaching rooms at Harlow College, have been laid out so that we are socially distancing to meet the COVID regulations. They're all cleaned and sanitized between each lesson. They're fully ventilated and we're using the correct PPE so learners can continue to do their practicals even in these difficult times. Next slide, please. Course costs. So we have limited costs that we like to, or that we feel we have to give to the learners. So we try to keep the costs down wherever possible. So the practicals that we do, we would ask for learners to provide a £20 cost to cover consumables for the many practicals they will do to meet the requirements for the programme. There is a textbook and revision guide that learners need to get. The cost would depend on whether they want to have an electronic copy, which they can then use on their iPad. Like I mentioned, all learners get an iPad, or if they want a hard copy, which they might prefer. If we're able to do trips and visits, then there might be a cost incurred to those, but we try to keep those costs to a minimum. And also learners will be required to buy a lab coat and goggles so that there's not a sharing of equipment and the risks that come with that. Next slide, please. Right, top tips for choosing applied science. So first of all, think very carefully. Are you interested in a career in science? Is this what you want to get into? Do you enjoy doing the practicals during your GCSEs? Because there is a lot of hands-on learning on the applied science course. Think about your GCSEs that you're taking and where your strengths lie. So maths as well as science is really important for the vocational science course, and obviously English for where learners are writing up their assignments. So we're saying to learners, if you work as hard as possible, which I'm sure you will be, it might be that you can leapfrog the level two science programme and go in on the level three programme. It's also a good idea to have an idea as to what kinds of careers you want to go into so that we can be looking at that to support you both with, have you chosen the right course at the college? Are there any alternatives? And how can we support you to meet that end destination? Next slide, please. So we've mentioned apprenticeships, and at the college we do offer a science apprenticeship. So it's the level three apprenticeship in laboratory technician. And as I've already mentioned, it's a really good alternative to doing courses. So the level three is equivalent to the level three applied science programme. Learners can lead on from a level three apprenticeship into higher apprenticeships. So that's where you do your degree alongside it. And it's where you would spend 4 days a week in your job and 1 day a week at college studying the level three programme. It's something that we discuss with learners if they're interested in doing, because we would need to find the placement with the employer in order to be able to offer the apprenticeship to the learner. Next slide, please. T-levels. So T-levels will be offered in the future in the science department. So these are a level three equivalent programme to the BTEC science that we currently offer. It's 2 years and the whole programme is equivalent to three A-levels, the same as the level three BTEC science. It's different to the current vocational programme that we offer in that the placements that learners have to do are much longer. So we're looking at least 315 hours of work placement, industrial placement. So this might be for learners who are thinking that they actually would quite like to get a lot more of their learning from sort of a workplace setting. Alongside that, learners would then be doing a qualification. Next slide, please. So student support that we offer at the college is extensive. The STAR agency works alongside the science department to support learners with careers advice, sorting work experience, financial advice, that sort of thing. We also have a safeguarding team. So if learners have any concerns about anything that's going on to do with their own safety or well-being or that of their peers, they can go to the safeguarding team either via a teacher or they can go there themselves. And we also offer learning support. So any support that a learner might be getting now during their GCSEs, that can continue at college, and that support can be put in place. And the learning support team will work with that young person to work out what's most appropriate. Next slide, please. So, Nick, what's next? Applications are open, so get online, get that application done. What will happen is it will trigger an interview at the moment they're being done on the phone, and then we will be able to support you with any other questions you might have about the vocational science programme. Next slide, please. Right, let's go and have a look at some of the questions that we've had coming in. I've seen some pinging up here, so we can go and see what we've got. Do you need a GCSE in the same subject? Wrong question there. Is it possible to study two A levels and the BTEC science? So no, the BTEC science is a program that you do all on your own. You wouldn't do it alongside A level programs. So the full level three applied science qualification, is it equivalent to two or three A levels, is one of the questions here as well. The extended diploma is equivalent to three full A levels. So this is why learners can go to university with it, because it is equivalent to three A levels, and three A levels is the entry requirement for the courses that learners are applying for. What other questions have we got? Will I get to do much practical work, not just theory? So absolutely, as I mentioned, we do lots of practical experiments covering all three science subjects. And during those, we're not only testing your theory knowledge, we're also developing your maths and your English skills, because you will write up those practicals into your assignments. And that coursework is then going to become part of your qualification. And also you might be tested on that knowledge and understanding during the exams on the programme. Right, I think we're probably coming up for the end of this programme. So if you've got any more questions on the vocational science programme, you can send those in to us and we will get those answered for you. As we've probably notice, we've got lots of different information that's going out on social media. So we would say to you, keep checking our social media, our Twitter feeds, our Facebook pages, to see any new information that's coming out about any events that we're doing, any other open evenings that we're able to do. Maybe soon we'll be able to do them on site and you'll be able to come around and have a look at the laboratories. If you've got any questions about your application online, you can contact the college and we will answer those questions and give you support completing that program, completing that application. Some schools do the application process as part of their tutorials, but sometimes they leave the learners to get on with it. So if you do have any questions, do feel free to contact us. So I'm now going to hand back to our host Leanne, and thank you very much for listening.
Thank you so much, Tracy. We're going to move on to our engineering open event now, and welcome to any new attendees that have joined us. If you have any questions you still would like to ask our science team, you can still ask those questions, no problem. Just make sure you ask your question with the word science at the beginning of your question. That way, Jane from our science team will know to answer your question, okay? Welcome everyone, thank you for joining us for our Harlow College Open event. I'm Leanne, I work for marketing and I will be overseeing this open event today, and also in the background is my colleague Jasmine, who will be helping me with that. Delivering your engineering open event today will be our engineering team. So how this webinar will work is our presenters will share their information with you. They can't see you, but you should be able to see them alongside any information they wish to share on screen. Our presenters and other attendees can't hear you, however, you will be able to ask questions throughout the webinar using the Q&A feature. If you're using a computer, this will be at the bottom of your screen. If you're using a mobile device, tap the screen and this will appear at the top. Someone will either answer your questions live or answer it on the Q&A feed. Ask your questions as we go along and we will save some time at the end of the subject presentations to answer as many as we can live. Please be aware that your name will appear next to your question, but you can click Ask Anonymously. We are recording this webinar and you will receive an email with a link to the recording. This will also be available on the Harlow College website. I'm now going to hand you back over to Tracy for our engineering open event. Don't forget to send in your questions using the Q&A feature.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Tracy Greenall and I'm the head of academy that includes A-levels, vocational science and the engineering teams. In this session, I'm going to give you some information about what it is like studying engineering at Harlow College. I'm joined by Matt Graham, who is the manager of engineering, who will be answering your questions during this session on the live Q&A feed. So do put those questions to him whilst I am going through the information. Next slide, please. So engineering, you might hear the word hammock mentioned quite a lot. This is our advanced manufacturing engineering centre at Harlow College, and it's where we're basing the engineering department. And it's a beautiful facility that we've got that I'm going to talk a lot more about during this session. Next slide, please. Right, so in the engineering department, we have a number of different qualifications that learners can go on to. And the level of qualification that learners start on depends on what their qualifications are on entry. And what they enroll on to depends on their desired progression pathway. So learners can go on to the level two program, and they have a choice for level two. They can either go on to the level two diploma in machining, which is classed as a full-time qualification, and this would then be with the view to going on to the level three program or the pre-apprenticeship in advanced manufacturing. And this then could allow learners to go on to an apprenticeship after this. The level three program has similar options. So learners can either do the level three extended diploma in general engineering. So this is a full-time engineering program, or they can do the level three pre-apprenticeship diploma. So this is again with that view to going on to an apprenticeship. And our level three extended diploma program is for learners who are thinking more likely they want to go on to a level four qualification. So that could be our HN that we offer here at the college. It could be going to a university elsewhere to do a degree, to do a higher apprenticeship. So this is where you do a degree alongside having a job or to go straight into a job. Next slide, please. So progression for our engineering learners is quite varied because we have such a variety of courses that we offer at both level two and level three. Many learners do progress into apprenticeships, and these apprenticeships, as I've already mentioned, go all the way up to degree level. Apprenticeships are a brilliant option for learners as it means they are completing their qualification alongside having a job. So this is enabling them to put the learning that they have acquired in the classroom into an industry setting. So they're going to be seeing how it works in practice. Now for our higher level program, so level four, that's our HNC, HND, if learners do the apprenticeship, they don't pay for the qualification. The employer covers the cost. So this is another benefit of doing an apprenticeship. Many engineering employers are now seeing the benefits of apprenticeships and really seeing it as a viable alternative to taking learners from a full-time qualification, because it means they're training that young person to be working in their company with their equipment and understanding their processes. So it saves them having to retrain that person when they hire them once they've graduated from a full-time course. Next slide, please. So the course content is varied. And it depends a little bit on the course that the learners do, but there is a huge amount of practical activity that the learners do. So we've got the classic kind of activities that learners are going to be doing, fitting assembly techniques, but also things like milling and turning. There is also a lot of maths within the programme. So maths is a really important skill for the learners to develop. And learners are also looking at things such as product design, so from the very beginning of looking at a design product they want to do, through to coming up with prototypes, through to actually manufacturing that item on the equipment that we have at the college in our Hammock Centre. So the learners are going through the processes that they would be doing if they were doing the project actually in the workplace. So we're training the learners the whole time to be going into the workplace to be undertaking these careers. Next slide, please. So what would a typical day look like for a learner? So if a learner is a full-time learner, so this is a learner on either our level 2 or level 3 programme, they would be in college 3 days a week. Their time in college would be a combination of classroom theory sessions as well as a lot of practical work using the industry quality equipment that we've got in the Hammock Centre, learning the tricks of the trade, as it were, on that equipment so that they can take those skills into a job. Now, learners who are on apprenticeships, 4 days of the week, they're actually in their job in the company, and then 1 day a week they come to college. And at college, again, they'll be doing a combination of theory and practical work. We also have a lot of online learning that learners would do, whether it would be revision or homework. And at the moment, some of the lessons that the learners are doing is online as a consequence of the COVID restrictions. So a lot of the revision and theory work the learners are doing is using the iPads that all learners get when they start a programme at Harlow College. Next slide, please. Work-related learning is obviously incredibly important for learners wanting to go into engineering. So we have industry placements for our learners who are on the diploma and any of the pre-apprenticeship courses, so level 2 and level 3. We have work experience for our BTEC learners. So the minimum we would expect learners to do is 30 hours. So that's a week's worth of work experience, but many learners do a lot more of that. And that is in addition to the work that they would be doing in the workshop sessions using our industry quality equipment. So the learners will be working with the technicians on the equipment, doing either equipment processes learning for their programmes, or also looking at live briefs where we're producing items for different companies, so they can see the whole process happening on. This allows the learners to understand the expectations that will be placed on them once they start working in an engineering industry placement. Next slide, please. So we've got some pictures here of students using the equipment. These are pictures from the Hammock Centre, the different equipment that we have. So you can see that we have top of the range equipment that the learners are using, and that's really important so that when they go into those work placements or when they acquire their apprenticeships, they're not intimidated by the equipment that they're finding in those work placements. They understand how it all works, they understand the processes. Next slide, please. And this is a view from the balcony looking over the workshop centre that we have at Hammock. So you can see the workstations that we have. It's a wonderful facility that we have here where the learners, like I say, are getting that industry quality experience. And it's also a great place for us to invite in outside organisations to come and talk about their companies, their types of engineering with our learners, so they get an idea as to the different kinds of careers that there are in the engineering field. Next slide, please. So I've already mentioned the industry quality equipment that we have here. So we have lots of different machines that we have put into the new Hammock Centre when it was built a couple of years ago. And we have lots of training that goes on with those machines, so the learners are confident using them, the different processes that they can do on them, as well as the health and safety that goes alongside them. Next slide, please. Course costs. So there are some course costs associated with the engineering programme. All learners would be expected to purchase their PPE, so their personal protective equipment, and this would include their overalls, safety boots and their glasses, which they would need whenever they come on campus, because as we said, a lot of the time they're going to be in that workshop setting. They need to buy textbooks for their programme, and they would need a calculator, as mentioned, lots of maths involved in the engineering programme. Next slide, please. So, top tips for learners thinking about coming into the engineering department. Think about whether you are better suited to an apprenticeship pathway or a main programme pathway. We have lots of apprenticeships that come in from companies, so these all go onto our website. So it's a really good idea to keep an eye on the website, on the Harlow College website, to see what's being advertised there and if any of those apprenticeships take your fancy. I've mentioned it many times, and I'll mention it again, maths is incredibly important for engineering. So think about how you're doing in your GCSE maths. Do you maybe need to spend a little bit more time revising on that to get your GCSE maths grade up? It's absolutely going to be essential if you are considering an engineering programme. Think about the different kinds of engineering that you can do. So it is varied. We do have lots of different types of engineering that learners progress into, and it is very specific. So learners might want to think about, are they into mechanical engineering? Do they want to be working in the area of motorsports? And we've had learners who have gone into working with Formula One companies. Are you more interested in environmental engineering? Are you thinking maybe you'd like to be looking at ways of creating more environmentally friendly machines? Are you wanting to come up with solutions to environmental problems, that sort of thing? And then how would you get to that career? Would you need to go to university to get a degree, or are there apprenticeships available for that pathway? And if so, can you start those at level two, or do you need to do your level three program and then go into a higher apprenticeship? We support learners with looking at progression throughout their time at Harlow College. So we would support learners whether they've decided they want to go the apprenticeship route, and we support them to find the appropriate apprenticeships, or whether they're thinking they might want to go the university route, we'd support with that process as well. Next slide, please. So I've talked quite a lot about apprenticeships because it is a main part of our engineering department. We do have different kinds of apprenticeships that learners can go into. So as it says there, our level three machinist technician, or a level three mechatronics maintenance technician. Learners might not be sure what kind of pathway would be right for them. It's absolutely fine to contact Harlow College, ask your questions, and the department can give you the kinds of information to help you decide which pathway might be right for you. Whether you go into the level two or level three program, as I've already mentioned, would depend on what your qualifications are on entry. If you're very much keen on the apprenticeship route, as we've said, we do put our apprenticeship vacancies on our website, but it might be that you know of a company that offers apprenticeships and you'd like to see if you could do get a placement with them that could then run your learning alongside your apprenticeship here at Harlow College. So sometimes learners come with the apprenticeship, or companies approach us and ask us to offer the college learning for that apprentice. Once you put your application in, we can discuss whether the full-time course or the apprenticeship option is more appropriate for you at your interview. At the moment, interviews are being done on the telephone, but hopefully soon in the future, we'll be able to do them face-to-face here at college. Next slide, please. So student support, we offer support to the learners throughout their time here at college. We have the STAR agency and they support the engineering team with offering careers advice, giving information, advice and guidance on the different kinds of programs that learners can do, as well as where they can progress to after their course. They also support the department with sorting work experience for the learners, giving financial support, that sort of thing. We have a safeguarding team. They're there for learners who might have any concerns about their own safety and well-being, or whether they are concerned about the safety or well-being of a friend. You can access the safeguarding department either via a teacher, or you can just go straight to them if you would rather. And then learning support. So in the same way that learners get support during their GCSEs for any learning needs they might have, that can continue at college. So you just need to make us aware of any learning support that you currently have, and we can support with getting that sorted here during your programme. Next slide, please. So applications are open. They're done online. Many of our local schools sort applications for Harlow College during things like tutorials. If your school doesn't offer that, just go on to the Harlow College website, click apply, and start filling in the application. If you've got any concerns or any questions, you can contact the college and we can support you with that so you can complete your application. Once you've submitted your application, you will get an interview date, and interviews will start in January. And as I've already mentioned, that might be where you want to delve a little bit deeper as to whether the full programme, the full-time programme, or the apprenticeship is a better pathway for you. Next slide, please. Right, let's have a look at some of the questions that we have got going on at the moment. Through the questions we have. So how many days will the engineering course be? So as I've already mentioned, the level three programs, they're 3 days a week for the programs here. So learners would be in for 3 days a week equivalent, and depending on the level. So if learners are doing level two, they might need to do that maybe English alongside that sort of thing. So that will determine how many days a week they're here at college. When do applications have to be in by? Good question. My advice would be get it in as soon as possible so you don't have to worry about it whilst you're studying for your GCSE. But actually, we never close our application process, so we are always taking applications from learners, so that includes throughout the summer. But as I've said, our advice is get it in as soon as possible so you don't need to be worrying about it. What do I need to buy for electrical engineering? So we mentioned the course costs on one of the slides. All learners have to have PPE. So you must have your overalls, you must have your safety boots, and you must have your goggles. And that goes for whatever program you're doing in the engineering department, whatever level. You will have your textbooks that you need to buy. You would have to put a deposit down for your iPad, because all learners have to have the iPad, but you get your deposit back once you return it. Right, I think that's about us done. If you've got any other questions or any that we haven't covered, we will be getting that information out to you. And keep an eye on our social media for any updates on any events going on at the college or in the engineering department. I'm now going to hand you back to Leanne, our host. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you so much, Tracy. We're going to move on to our Supported Studies Open event now and welcome to any new attendees that have joined us today. If you would still like to ask those burning engineering questions, you absolutely can. Just make sure that you ask your question with the word engineering in front of your question so the engineering team know to answer your question. Welcome everyone, thank you for joining us for our Harlow College Open event. I'm Leanne, I work for marketing and I'll be overseeing this open event today, and also in the background is my colleague Jasmine, who will be helping me with that. Delivering your Supported Studies Open event today will be our Supported Studies team. So how this webinar will work is our presenters will share their information with you. They can't see you, but you should be able to see them alongside any information they wish to share on screen. Our presenters and other attendees can't hear you. However, you will be able to ask questions throughout the webinar using the Q&A feature. If you're using a computer, this will appear at the bottom of your screen. If you're using a mobile device, tap your screen and this Q&A feature will appear at the top. Someone will either answer your questions live or they will answer it on the Q&A feed. Ask your questions as we go along, ask as many as you possibly can, and we will save some time at the end of the subject presentation to answer as many as we can live. Please be aware that your name will appear next to your question, but you can click Ask Anonymously. We are recording this webinar and you will receive an email with a link to the recording. This will also be available on the Harlow College website. I'm now going to hand you over to our Head of Supported Studies, Selena, for our Supported Studies Open event. Don't forget to send in your questions using the Q&A feature.
Hello there, my name's Selena Avery and I'm the Head of the Supported Studies area. I'm accompanied today by Eddie Marriott, who is one of our teachers, and he's busily answering any of your questions. So please do go ahead and answer any questions, ask any questions that you may have. Next slide, please. Okay, so within supported studies, we have students that have some additional needs and with mild to moderate provision. And really our sort of main aim is to sort of to help them into adulthood. We work to the preparing for adulthood agenda. So we have different course levels and progression. If you're coming straight out of school, sort of at 16, you're more than likely suitable for our Towards Independence and Work group. This will help you settle into college and we have a wide variety of activities, which I'll talk about shortly. We also have our Links Plus group and our Links to Work group. Now they might be courses that you progress on to in the following year, or if you're a little bit older, you've perhaps been at school into sixth form or been at another college, then that might be a more suitable option for you, where we focus a little bit more on employment opportunities. We have our Into Work group, which is our supported internship programme, and that is usually the last port of call for most of our students. By the time they get there, they've gained in confidence and they're ready to start thinking about going out into the workplace. With our supported internship programme, we help them find a suitable placement and we support them into that workplace, which is unpaid to start with. It forms part of their course. But then as time goes on and their confidence builds, we usually have an arrangement with the employer that it will lead to at least 4 hours paid employment, which is a good step into employment for a lot of our learners. And finally, we have our prospects course, which is our adult provision. Again, this is quite employment focused. They'll do a level one customer service skills course. But also alongside that, we have Job Club, where we help to support them to seek real employment opportunities and support them with their interview skills, their actual applications. And if they gained an interview, we would support them with that as well, where we could. Next slide, please. So, as I say, many of our learners do progress into paid employment once they've worked through our programme. Last year, we had an 83% success rate of students that went into paid employment. And those that didn't quite manage that, they then moved on to our prospects course. So, and they're having another go this year where they've built in a little bit more confidence as well. Others that come to our department may move on to a mainstream course within the college. So it's quite normal for new students that have come straight from school. They may be a little bit nervous about college due to their sort of anxieties. So having a year with us in the Towards Independence and Work group helps to build that confidence, gets them settled into college and then ready maybe to move on to one of our vocational courses in mainstream the following year. And what we can arrange for them is some tasters in those areas. So examples where we have done this would be students have moved on to hospitality where we have a really good sort of level one course there that they can progress through. Also other options have been sort of, they've moved on to business and some of them into the construction trades. So there are options, sort of a two-tier option, either an employment focus or thinking about getting some further training on a vocational course. Next slide, please. So our course content across all of our courses, it will involve some element of all the things listed here. So for all our courses, English and maths is a focus, very, very important. And we work on skills for life for that. So it's working to the preparing for adulthood agenda. So the sorts of things that they're going to need to gain more independence. So we might, all of our activities might involve elements of English and maths. So we'll have things like budgeting. So if we do a cooking activity, for example, in our kitchen that we have, it wouldn't just be a case of us getting the ingredients for them. They'd need to plan their recipe. They'd need to sort out what they'd need to get and the costs, things like that. And they'd have to actually go and get it from the shops as well, obviously with our support. So there's money skills involved there as well. We also do employment skills in all of the groups, even towards independence and work group, where they just start to touch on thinking about what they might like to do for employment. But as we progress through the courses, they will do more in-depth study of their employment skills and start to really think about what they might like to do and how they can go about that. We have health and well-being, which is really important and covers a lot of things that you need to know when you're an independent young adult, and how to look after yourself, your well-being, and even things like arranging doctor's appointments and things like that. So we cover a wide multitude of things there. All of our students have some element of work experience while they're with us. At the moment, during COVID, we've got some restrictions on that, but usually we've got a very, very wide variety of work experience. We also have our shop over in the town centre, which is called In The Making. It's in the Harvey Centre, where we make and produce items to sell, and the students have an opportunity to practice their customer service skills there and also all aspects of running a shop. We have a new IT skills course this year, which Eddie, who's on the questions, he's devised that, and the students are really enjoying that at the moment. And that's something that we're hoping to expand further because a very important skill for work and life. We have art and design sessions where the students will be making stuff for the shop. And we also have art therapy sessions as well. And we use the leisure zone for sport. And we have a lady come in to do yoga with us as well, which is a lot of students didn't quite want to do that at first, but we kind of won them over, and they really do enjoy the yoga, and it's a nice way of relaxing and really good well-being session. Next slide, please. So a typical day in supported studies, we don't really have a typical day. Every day is different. We try to learn both inside and outside the classroom. We enjoy lots of activities and trips. Many of our learners have their own bespoke timetable suited to their goals and interests. We often find that students may come and have very definite ideas about what they want to do. And we always like to talk to them. We get to know them very well within the first 6 weeks. If they have an EHCP, that's studied in depth to see what they want. And we also have what's called a PCP meeting, where we will meet with parents, with the student and anyone else that they want to be there to talk about their goals and interests. And we try to meet those when they come to us. The day starts at 9:30 and finishes at 3 o'clock. We have an hour for lunch, whereby learners can access clubs and activities to further develop their social skills. We have all the groups apart from the interwork group, the supported internships and the prospects are a 4 to 5 day programme. And the prospects and the supported internship is a 3 day program. Next slide, please. So there's a full program of work experience opportunities that caters to a wide range of interests. And we really feel that this makes a difference to our learners and builds their confidence, both in the workplace and also it's a chance for them to, sometimes for the first time in an education environment, they are feeling like they're being treated as an adult. And we call them young adults, and we expect them to behave as young adults as well. I've mentioned already, we have the shop in the Harvey Centre, so that's a really, really good resource for us. And teaches them all aspects as well. And we even have students that come and volunteer on a Saturday as well to work in the shop. We have many outdoor placements as well. So these include Royal Gunpowder Mills in Waltham Abbey, and we have our minibus. We go there to do some work there. We go to Harlow Town Park on a regular basis. And we also have Epping-Ongar Railway. So we go there. And then lots of other opportunities that we have. We work with Rainbow Services, and they give us lots of different opportunities that are different to the outdoor work. So maybe catering, working in a cafe, things like that. So a nice big wide range of work experience. For the learners that are a little less confident, we have opportunities within the college itself where they'll do some work experience as well. Next slide, please. So it's just a few little photos and some examples of our students at work. So on the left there is one of our gardening projects on a nice sunny day, but we do go whatever the weather, so we do have to prepare them for that as well. In the middle there, we've got a lovely big room that we have that we make lots of use of for lots of different activities rather than just sitting at a desk. And they're actually taking part in their yoga session there. And there on the right, that is our supported studies kitchen, where we don't just make cakes all day. We're really teaching them how to live independently, cook independent meals, healthy meals. We talk about healthy diets. And we're actually in the process of raising money, and we're getting quite close to our target now to revamp our kitchen. And the students have been instrumental in raising those funds, so that's something else that they're sort of getting involved in. Next slide, please. Some other facilities there. So there on the left, so we have some clubs sometimes, with after school clubs, and it depends what the students might want to do. This is a science club up in the science lab, and that was really enjoyed. And on the right there, we've got some team building activities that we did in our big room again. And we also have a sensory room as well, where if students are feeling a little bit anxious, they can go and have a bit of quiet time in the sensory room. And again, that was actually put together by our students, so we do try to get them involved in everything that we do. Next slide, please. Course costs, you would, all our students in the college, in the whole college, but in supported studies also, will have the use of an iPad. And there is a deposit for that, but that is there for the duration of the course. And we do use it a lot for our learning, and it's been really helpful during this lockdown time, where some of our learning has been online, but the students very quickly get very confident with that, and we're able to utilise the iPad really, really well. We also have trips and visits throughout the year. If there's a cost involved, we do let you know well in advance. Many of our trips do not carry a charge, because we do make full use of our minibus to get out and about. Little photos there on the left, this is some of our students' first trip on a tube. That was a really enjoyable day in London. So all they needed to pay for there was just the train fare. And on the right there, we visit Harlow Playhouse every year for the pantomime, which is usually a really nice end to the term. If you're entitled to a bursary payment, then we can sort that out for you as well, and that will make it a little bit easier. Next slide, please. So student support, ourselves within supported studies are very, very supportive, and you'll find a whole host of staff that will be here to help you. But we also have our college support as well. So we have the STAR agency, which will help with admissions, careers advice, work experience, and that's where you would get support with your bursary and your travel as well. We have a safeguarding team who will have an umbrella over any safeguarding requirements. The first port of call is usually to us within the team, but we can always escalate to safeguarding if there's a need. And the learning support, within supported studies, we've got a very big team, teachers and coaches and support workers. And all our students will have a key worker who it will be that their main port of call to go to if they've got any worries or concerns. So the support is very strong here in the college. Next slide, please. So we can get ready to think about applying. Please do apply as soon as you can. Within supported studies, obviously the majority of our students have education, health and care plans. So it's really, really important to get your application in early so that we can look at that and assess that whether we can meet your needs and start that dialogue. So please do apply as soon as you can. But applications are online. If you do struggle with that, quite often we find that the school that you're currently at will help you with your application. Or if not, just give us a call and we can help you through that as well. Next slide, please. Okay, so that's the end of the presentation. I'm just going to have a look now and see what questions we might have. Okay, so I have a question. Hi, my daughter has Down syndrome. She would like to learn dancing, cooking and baking. She's in mainstream school at Burnt Mill and learning level one dancing and BTEC cooking. Can you please give me some more information on this? Well, we do have, as I mentioned before, we have our hospitality department, which they do a level one course in hospitality. So that could be an option. Possibly if she's coming straight out of Burnt Mill, it might be nice for her to go the route of coming into towards independence and work to start with, so that she can get used to the college and being in the college, build her confidence a little bit, and we'd give her some tasters in hospitality. We do also have a performing arts area as well. So it might be that we could talk about that in more depth at an interview. If you apply online, that will then generate an interview. And I think that would be a good way to sort of talk about that in a little bit more depth. Many of our learners, we do find sort of in the past, pre-COVID, most of our applicants do come and have a little visit, first of all. But whilst we're unable to do that at the moment, if you wanted to call, then I'm more than happy to talk everything through with you. So what is the cost of a deposit for the iPad and does the student keep it at the end of the course? This year it was £50 and you will get that refunded to you at the end of the programme. And if you're on bursary, then you do not pay for that. It's paid for through bursary. My other son is at college and does some super work on their iPad, which has been really helpful for them. How do you use the iPad in your classes? Well, that's something that's developing more and more and more. We do lots and lots of things. We have quizzes on there. A lot of the students love to use Kahoot, which helps to remind them what they've learned in the session. We do lots of, all our work is through Shobi, so they will access that on there. Creating lots of digital resources on there, research, taking photos. What a lot of parents really like is the fact that their young person will come home from college and be able to share things with them that they've done that day. And that's something that perhaps hasn't happened before. So they'll come home and they can show a photo of, say, maybe if they've been over at the town park, they might show a photo and that generates some conversation. Which has been really good for their communication skills as well. So how do we apply, please? You can apply through the college website, just put supported studies in the search bar to find our section and make your application. Don't worry too much. which sort of level within supported studies. We talk about that interview and see what's the best fit for your young person. I've heard you had a therapy dog. Can you explain how that works? Well, you might have seen Lula in the video prior to joining me. We have a therapy dog called Lula. She's 10 months old at the moment, and we are training her and teaching her at the moment how to be a good therapy dog. The students love her, and she's really, really good when any students have a little bit of anxiety. You know, they might want to take her for a walk or go and sit in the sensory room with her, and it's been really, really good. If your young person is a bit nervous of dogs, then obviously we're very mindful of that, so please don't worry about that either. And is there work experience for everyone on the course? I did give some ideas of different work experience that was available, and that's growing all the time. So yes, every student will do some form of work experience. Okay, so thank you very much. If you do have any more questions, please do put them through, and we'll have a look afterwards. I'm just going to hand back now to Leanne.
Thank you so much, Selena. Selena, whilst you were answering those last couple of questions, we had a few more come in, and I was wondering if you would mind answering them for our attendees today. So we're going to bat it back. We're going to pass back to you, Selena.
Okay, my son may potentially be bridging supportive studies and mainstream. Does this work successfully? Yes, that can work successfully. Obviously, that sounds like quite a bespoke opportunity. So that would be quite good if you could perhaps give me a call. I am here Monday to Friday, and we can talk through that in a little bit more detail. But yes, we have done that before. They've had a little bit of time in supported studies, really to kind of work on sort of the confidence and having that supportive network around them, and then perhaps going into mainstream for something. Sometimes, depending on the student, they may have support with that as well. So that's something probably better if we speak about it one-to-one, but we are very, very open and flexible within supported studies, and we will try to make, you know, whatever works best for the student, make that work, okay. Are there some subjects that all students take, or are they all optional? What type of assessments do students do? How does it differ from what they might do at the end of a special secondary school? We are a non-accredited area, so we don't actually do qualifications within supported studies. We work to the Preparing for Adulthood agenda. If you want some more information on that, then if you just Google it, that will give you lots of information about the Preparing for Adulthood agenda works. We do have some students that might particularly want to continue with their English and maths. So we can arrange that, and that would be with a mainstream group, but we can support them with that. But actually in our area, we don't do qualifications as such. We do a baseline assessment with them when they come in for English and maths to see where they're at and what sort of skills they need to develop. So for example, we may have students come in that their money skills are really poor, and we know that we need to focus on that, but it will be all the sort of skills for life things that we are actually focusing on. I hope that answers your question, but again, if you want to call me, I can go through things in more detail and answer any further questions on that. Creative writing course, not within supported studies, but maybe in mainstream. Just really GCSE English, I believe. So maybe someone from the English team might be able to answer that one for you. Okay, I think that's everything. Is it just English and maths GCSE level that you do with the mainstream group? Generally, that will be students that are, if they've got a grade 3 in their previous qualification at school, then they would qualify to do GCSE English and Maths here to continue to try to get grade 4. Okay, otherwise it will be functional skills. Okay, I think that's everything. Just like to hand you back to Leanne.
Hi, thank you very much for joining us today. We hope you've got a lot out of our open event today. Our online applications are now open, so head over to our Harlow College website to apply online today. We will drop you an email with this session recording. We would really appreciate it if you could spend just a couple of minutes filling out our survey so we can really continue to improve this service. Don't forget, you can also download our brand new digital prospectus. It's gone completely digital this year and is jam-packed full of information, videos and 360 tours. You can download and view our prospectus on our Harlow College website. If you want to hang, we're going to hang around for 5 minutes longer to answer those remaining questions on the Q&A feed. So if you have asked a question, we will answer those now and it will appear in the feed. Thank you very much for joining us and we enjoy the rest of your evening.